Hey everybody, on this episode of AfterBuzz TV Spotlight On, we're getting up close and personal with actor Rich Graff. Let's do it.
You're tuning into the destination for TV superfan discussion, AfterBuzz TV. And now, let the buzz begin.
Look at that, Frank Sinatra welcoming us into this AfterBuzz TV Spotlight On. This is the show, of course, where we get up close and personal with the people both in front and behind the camera. We'll bring you all that great entertainment you can watch at your own home, on the big screen, maybe on your mobile streaming devices. I'm your host for this show. I forgot my name. I was so excited. Frank Moran. You can follow me on Twitter and Instagram at Happy Go Jackie. Now, my guest today, he's pretty much got a start in front of the camera since pretty much the moment he was born. Since then, he's gone on to do a wide variety of things. We're talking about chef, Olympic-caliber snowboarder, author, pilot, musician, and a lawyer and acting. Now, he's also been in the film My Dead Boyfriend with Heather Graham, and you may remember him as Lucky Luciano in the AMC miniseries The Making of the Mob. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome, Rich Graff.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for having me.
Oh, my gosh, the pleasure's all mine. Now, I started off right there. It's like pretty much since the moment you were born. And you were a Gerber baby.
Yeah. Yeah, it was weird. There was a, must have been a nurse who knew someone in the business and saw this baby. And there was somebody waiting in the whole, in the lobby of the hospital for my parents. And, you know, offered to put me on the Gerber label. So kind of weird. It's like one of those stories you can't make up.
No, that's...
Yeah.
Now, was your mom something like that, that collected all those things that when you were the Gerber baby, like, oh, here's a box,
Well, there's a new one every year. You know, even now, they get a new one every year. I was at an audition like 2 years ago, and they were auditioning little picture that they don't bring the babies in. They just like kind of like look at the pictures, but yeah.
She have a little memorabilia, but that's, this is...
No, she keeps pictures of me like with my genitalia hanging out, like... it's an Italian kind of, and a Jewish thing, I think, you know. They're proud of their male.
There you go. This is my son. This is my son.
That's right.
Did it, having those things kind of holding up when you're dating, is that something you kind of refrain from maybe bringing somebody home? Because you're like, I don't want to see
the photos. Well, it's the first pictures. It's the first page. You know, those are the first pictures of the book.
Yeah.
So you can't get away from it. It's the first thing you see.
Like, no, let's can we go to page 5 and start there?
That book is hidden away somewhere.
So would you say that that was the moment kind of like the acting bug kind of bit you, even though unconsciously for you? I mean, you don't really realize that.
You know, I was just, I think there's something people are born with, and it could be anything creative, you know, and it's whether or not you aren't afraid to kind of like explore within that, because, you know, I believe anyone that's really creative, and that's someone who creates their own thing out of a, you know, a broad topic, has to have a lot of guts and a lot of confidence in knowing what the outcome is going to be, you know. And I've always been that kind of kid that got up at a wedding when the band was off eating dinner and would grab the mic and sing to everybody. Or I was making movies with my friends without any cameras or anything like that. And people, I was saying cut, and people were like, who the hell are you talking to? You know, so it was like one of those things. I just always, it was always there. It wasn't something that I tried to do. It was there.
Now, from what I was reading, that your parents weren't necessarily supportive of you pursuing a role, a life as an actor.
Right.
So as you've done all these other pursuits, as I was listening, like Olympic caliber snowboarder, chef, author, lawyer, was that just other pursuits trying to find that same kind of thrill that you had from acting?
I've always been one of these people who, you know, when I do something, I don't do it a little bit. It's always to the extreme, you know, like I snowboarded biggest mountains in the world. You know, at times I was above the clouds, and, you know, I grew up in New York City. I was working at a restaurant as a busboy when I was 12 years old. So the cooking and my mom being, you know, Sicilian, my parents, food was always around. So I always latched on to things, and I always kind of like took it a step further. In music, I was playing several different instruments by ear by a very early age. But it was always acting. That was one of those things that I knew I could do even more. Because, let's say a musician. I happen to think being a successful musician is the hardest creative field. Because there are so many creative people, like so many talented people, but they just don't have that kind of look, or they don't have that kind of appeal for the camera per se, you know. But for me, acting was always it.
Now, you mentioned your mom and your parents from both from Sicilian.
Born in Sicily, yeah.
So now, even though you grew up, you love to cook. You've been around restaurants, different chefs. Is there still like a dish that your mom makes that still tops anything that you've ever had anywhere else?
You know, she makes the best sauce. My mom, yeah. We used to make a year's worth of sauce in one day. She had a pot that would go from the floor to like pretty, and I'm 6'1", pretty much up to my chin. It was like huge. Huge, and it with like ball jars all over the place. It was crazy.
I feel like something like with sauce, like it only gets better, like the more it kind of.
Well, that's the whole thing. It has to ferment. It has to kind of. You like put a blanket over them, and they stay there for like 6 months, and then you give them away to a lot of people and stuff, you know. But it's delicious.
Oh man, does she still make it as much?
She doesn't do that. You know, that was one of those things that we did when we were young, and it was like a whole like crates of tomatoes all over the place, like your body covered in sauce. Disgusting.
That's gonna be the fun though when you get a chance to get your hands dirty with a parent doing an activity that that's like really kind of like a family tradition.
I think like cooking, it's one of those things that my parents, we were at the dinner table the exact same time every day. We went out to eat pizza, McDonald's when I was a kid, like once in a while. But you know, and I think that's true of any kind of like culture where you're actually coming from that country. It's food is a big, big deal. You know, it's like it binds you together.
Are you an only child?
Oh, no, I have an older brother, younger sister.
Okay, so sort of like having all five of you then, or six of you around the five of you. I'm doing my math correctly. Five of you around the dining table. Mm-hmm. Easy to do or hard to do?
You know, it was easy. You know, because you were hungry, so all you wanted to do is eat. You know, I was always the one that kind of like, I don't know. I was always just focused on eating. I don't know. I never didn't meet a dish I didn't want to eat, I guess. I don't know.
So, all right, as you're talking about, we're talking about food. And we talked a little bit of this before the interview started there. From New York, I feel like I've gone to New York and I've never had like a pizza that's blown me away. Tell me a place that I could go to New York that would prove me wrong.
Well, there's an infamous or famous pizza in my neighborhood called New Park Pizza. That's really good because, and I think it tastes good because it actually has that wood-burning stove. So you get that like natural heat and the flavor from the smoke of the wood on the pizza, and it's thin and the sauce is good. That's the trick. The wood-burning stove, that's the best.
Now, how as much as you kind of grew up and you were cooking and working in kitchens, how much cooking do you do today?
I do it all the time.
Really?
Yeah.
Are you like the go-to place that Rich is cooking, everybody come over to his place?
Well, I don't know about that. In New York City, nobody cooks. I mean, nobody cooks. And I'm sure it's the same thing here in L.A. You know, and food is so cheap and so easy to get, just like wherever you go, you know. But I particularly like to cook my meals, even if I have to save it and warm it up the next day. I don't know. For me, it's not just the eating part. The cooking itself is kind of therapeutic in a way.
I can understand. For me, I always felt like I need a bigger place. That's always my excuse for never really cooking at home. Like, I need a bigger kitchen. Is that a case, or is that like you can cook in no matter how small?
Of course, you can cook it. You know, if you're only cooking for yourself or two or three people, any typical small little kitchen in an apartment should do. Depending on what you're cooking. Now, if you kind of, you know, if you need a grill and all that stuff, you know.
I need everything.
I feel like we're talking about a cooking. That's right. Become the cooking show.
That's right. So now, your brother and sister, did they decide to pursue anything in the artistic?
No, they're corporate America. They're like a corporate elite, and you know, my brother's like a CFO of a company, and my sister is an attorney for the city of New York, and yeah, I was the black sheep, I guess, of the family. You know.
Did it feel like that growing up?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Especially if your parents didn't really support an artistic kind of acting profession.
You know, I think that's that middle child syndrome where, you know, the older son is like, you know, up here and the daughter's the baby. And you have that little middle child who's allowed to like run around. I was in New York City nightclubs when I was like 16 years old, hanging out with adults like. I got a lot done as a young child, and I think that actually helps me because now I'm so mellow. I'm so kind of like, you know.
What's it like? Do you feel like you just kind of emotionally matured a lot quicker being in those sort of situations?
Yeah, I mean it's the environment that I grew up in, the people I grew up around, and I was always like that kind of like I always hung out with like the older crowd, or you know, that's a New York City kind of thing too. You know, you grow up very fast there.
Well, as I was reading up, you were growing up best friends with one of the members of the sons of the Gotti family.
Right. So John Gotti had three sons, one of whom was killed on a motor scooter. It wasn't a bicycle. Then there's John Jr., of course, and my friend growing up was Peter. And yeah, and it's funny how I, you know, came to play Lucky Luciano, and had a, you know, and I think that helped me with the role, of course. Being in that environment and seeing firsthand what they're really like. Because the people sometimes that you see in the films are not very interesting, but the people in real life, those are the real characters. You know, those are the people who really kind of have these personalities like, wow, somebody really does this on a day-to-day basis, you know?
How do you feel like the Sopranos came close to kind of capturing that? Was that a more closer portrayal?
You know, the Sopranos was actually pretty well done later on in the series. I didn't really watch it early on because, as I said, everything for me is kind of like, it was made to make money off of a genre. But later on, The Sopranos actually became really interesting to me because it got into other things in social arenas. It was very similar because, you know, gangsters, they don't like have regular jobs. They can't spend money like normal people do because, you know, the IRS, whoever is tracking what they spent. So you go to a gangster's house and they'll have like this beautiful rug, but there's like a burn mark on the back or something where it fell off the back of a truck. You know what I mean? Like it's like different. It's like weird in a sense. I don't know if I could explain it, but.
But growing up around that, is that something that becomes enticing or do you realize like that is so much more to try to do something like that?
No. When you're young, when I was like 12 years old, you remember Goodfellas, where Ray Liotta as a young child was parking Cadillacs. That was me. I was doing that. I was actually doing that as a 12-year-old. But as you get older and you see your best friend's older brothers disappearing, you know, you realize it's true what Al Pacino says in, I forgot the film, but it's your best friend who kills you. And you have to realize, and you have to have that in the back of your head. And you have to get out before it's too late.
Now, were your parents, were kind of like, you could be friends with them, but I only go so far?
I was lucky enough to be able to grow up with them. So there's that kind of bond, that childhood bond, where you grow up. I was fighting with John Gotti's youngest son, you know, as a child. Like, I didn't know who he was. His dad hadn't killed Paul Castellano yet. And you meet all of these people, like, you know, Robert De Niro's character in Goodfellas, Jimmy Burke is the real name. I was friends with his son, Jesse. It's weird. It's a strange life from, you know, but as a child, you don't know any better. But when you're older, you do.
Did you feel at any point that you may be pressured or you may have interest in pursuing that?
No, your parents were like, not at all. I knew as I grew up that I needed to like, step away. You know, if you either have that internal compass or you don't. And it's those people who unfortunately get enticed by that smoking gun mirror that they're luring you with, and eventually is what your downfall is. You know, you have to be able to kind of step away.
Is it easy on the other side for your friends to understand why you're kind of stepping away from that?
No, that's their life. When you're born into that life as a gangster, there is no other way because that's how they know how to live and make money. So I'm glad I wasn't born that way.
Yeah, no, yeah. That's for sure.
Right.
So you're also dabbling. You're doing cooking. As you said, you kind of grew up as a latchkey kid. So you had to start learn how to make your own food.
Right.
You know, working as a busboy, growing up in that realm. What made you decide, like, you know what, I don't want to pursue cooking as a passion. I'd rather go off and do other stuff.
It's true what they say about chefs. They are crazy. Like, I grew up in kitchens where they literally did throw like pots and pans and scream at sous chefs and stuff. So you knew that. I knew from a very early age I did not want to go through that. Like, they're nuts. They're neurotic because they are perfect. Like, I'm a perfectionist, but I don't need to be a perfectionist cook. I like to eat. That's enough for me. You know?
Does the same thing apply for being a snowboarder? Because if you get up to the level of Olympic caliber, I'd imagine that any training that's like drop every other interest you have in life, and this should be your pursuit.
Anything physical has a shelf life. You know, football, baseball, whatever. You know, you get hurt, you you're past your prime, you're always chasing what you used to have, you know, and it's unfortunate to see some players who can't let go. So for me, you know, getting to that level of snowboarding, I felt happy. I felt I had enough. Yeah.
How often do you snowboard now?
Now I don't. I haven't snowboarded in like 4 years.
Do you miss it at all?
I do miss it, but it's one of those things where like I can't just go to like a regular mountain and just kind of, you know, I need to like go to like some big mountain and, you know, have fun.
And I just can't
risk getting hurt.
Yeah. All right, man. I can know how to snowboard. I feel like I'd be doing as much as possible.
I probably will later on. It's just, you know.
You got other stuff going on.
I got other stuff going on. Stuff
that requires you to be able to walk around.
That's right.
Yes.
That's right.
So then you also a lawyer as well.
I used to, yes.
Yes. What made you, was it anything to do with your childhood, kind of seeing some of the other side of the law that made you want to pursue kind of stuff on the other side?
No,
being a lawyer?
Going to school, getting that education. I'll always be happy. I'll always cherish. But it was not what I wanted to do, really. It was more my parents. They never wanted me to get into the business. In fact, I was working full-time and taking acting classes at night and auditioning. Like, while I was working, like, had a suit on, would go to a bathroom stall of a restaurant and change into something else and then change back for, like, 3 or 4 years, and my parents never knew about it.
How did they react when they did find out?
They saw me on TV.
Did you tell them ahead of time?
No, they just kind of like, and then they gave me a call and I'm like, yeah. So, and then I quit my job. You know, it was one of those things where it's in life, there's never a perfect situation. You're always like, oh, I'm going to leave when I have this much money and I have this going on. It's never like that. You have to kind of live for the day.
Now, I was reading, when it was coming to time towards the end of your father's life there, that you had a kind of an epiphany about just like that, wanting to lead a life of regret.
Yeah. Well, I think that was one of those leap of faiths when I saw my dad passing away, where I'm like, you know what? I feel that my dad not regretted, but felt unfulfilled in a sense, because he was limited. I mean, he was an immigrant from Sicily. Did not have a college education. My mom had a college education. My mom made more money than my dad. Never felt like that in the house. But I felt like, and my dad and I are very similar in the sense that he, in spite of the fact that he may have been limited, he was a very driven individual. I mean, my mom and dad did things for us and sacrificed so much for us and were able to do so much. I can't, it's that era of people that came here with nothing in their pocket and developed this grand scheme and actually fulfilled it. I can only dream of doing half as much as they did.
I feel like it's one thing as a child to kind of almost take what your parents are providing for you for granted, because you don't really know. But as you get older and realize that your parents are also people too, who have their own dreams and aspirations, right? That I'm gonna have to put those on hold to put their children first.
Yeah. I wanted to be able to kind of like say, you know what, Dad, here, I did this for you, kind of.
So your first role, Law and Order, Criminal Intent.
Right.
Look at that. So playing a Queens cop.
Right. It was a Queens detective. I found the main clue in the case. But what's funny about that is that it was when Jeff Goldblum was on the show. And, you know, I had never met him before. And I walked up to him. I said, Jeff, I just want you to know I've always been a fan. Like the first time I saw a naked woman was with my mom and I was watching The Fly. And he kind of looked at me like, thanks for letting me know. We had a good laugh about it, but yeah, he's an interesting character, an interesting guy, very intelligent guy.
I feel like he's just one of those actors that you can just, he's just always makes interesting choices.
Yeah. You know, it kind of looks silly on set, but when you see it on film, you're like, man, how do you make it look that good? You know?
I guess that way it was something how it looks in person to way it translates on screen.
Right.
Which is very...
Right. Because, you know, as an actor, you never know what the editor or what the people behind the camera is going to do.
So now being in New York, acting, what's the auditioning process like in New York? Is it as crazy as what it seems to be like out here?
You know, I think it's the same. I honestly think, unfortunately, wherever you go, you have these people who are kind of looking to fill seats. And I feel like a lot of these auditions nowadays aren't even real, to be honest with you. I feel like a lot of these casting directors have these roles filled, and they're just having these auditions just to kind of like, they're legally obligated to do it. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
And it's unfortunate because you have these actors, these talented actors, who may not have like the hugest agency or the biggest managers, who aren't getting a fair share. You know, and a lot, I feel like a lot of the opportunities that I've gotten is because maybe a bigger, higher level actor has turned down something, you know, and that's the way it goes sometimes. But I think Hollywood and the film industry is in for, you know, a rude awakening, and you can see it happening. What was it, 70% of the Golden Globes, what are the awards for the TV? Golden Globes or
the Emmys.
The Emmys were for non-network shows, mm-hmm. all on Hulu, Netflix, and stuff like content that was originally created somewhere else, non-network. And they're going to have to start waking up to that.
No, and even with films, too, if you just see, like, Get Out, just like a smaller budget film that, I mean, just did so well.
Right. What was that other film that won the Best Picture for the Academy Award or did it?
Oh, Moonlight, yes.
Right. You never, and that wasn't even in large theaters, that was in small venues, so who knows? I don't know.
So wanting to pursue acting, who are people that you've kind of always put on the mantle, so to speak? That you kind of.
It's a great question. People think of Robert De Niro as this gangster and tough guy, but I mean, if you ever watched him in Awakenings, with Robin Williams, yeah. It was amazing. You think of Sean Penn, same thing. I mean, he played these tough guys like in Casualties of War. And there was another film with him in New York with these Irish gangsters. I can't think of the name of it, but it was a great film. It was about the Irish mob in New York, and it was him. It's a great, I cannot think of the name of it. But those guys, you know, great. Gary Oldman is an underappreciated actor, especially in his younger days. Mm-hmm. Really good actor. I don't like today's focus on the CGI and the pretty people. And I it's not tangible. It's not something that people want to see more than once. You know, a good film is something that people will buy, spend the money not only to see in the theater, but to buy a DVD or whatever, to buy a digital copy, so they can relive the experience, because that's what a film is really about. It's the human experience.
Yeah, no matter how splashy it is, if you don't have characters at the center of it that you can care about and root for, then it makes it tough to want to have it.
Something that's real and tangible, and good actors, not just people who, you know, that look, I don't know. Not for me.
Do you enjoy the auditioning process, or do you feel like it's just, this is a necessary evil, but boy, being in the room is not really a lot of fun?
No, I like it because, I mean, maybe 7 out of 10 won't get seen, but the 3 out of the 10, they're going to see something. And as an artist, you know when you're on and when you've done something well. And as long as somebody sees that, I know I'm going to get an opportunity. And I've auditioned for some really big people recently. I was with Eileen May, who was Mike Nichols' partner, and they had me on their radar. You know, I've been doing a lot of stuff, so it's not in vain, trust me.
And what's it like for your mom to go from somebody that was kind of resistant for you doing this to when did she kind of turn to being like a cheerleader?
When she saw me actually working.
Yeah, it's like, all right, okay, you can do this.
Because, it's true. There are a lot of people who are talented and for whatever reason don't get an opportunity. And it's sad. It's for me to see some people that I know that are really talented not having opportunities. It's hard for me. So as a parent, I can't imagine what it's like to see your son or your daughter going into this business that is so, what's the word that I'm looking for, where their families are helping them. Oh, God. Whatever that word is.
Enabling or no?
Well, you know.
Yes.
Where it's really criminal. It's really, you know, it's not fair. And to see your son or your daughter trying to succeed in that, it's got to be tough to, like, kind of, like, pull back and, you know, allow them to fail at times, because that's the biggest obstacle and the biggest precursor to success is your ability to kind of overcome your failures.
Now, as somebody who has said you're a perfectionist when it comes to pursuing things that you are passionate about, like being a cook, being a lawyer, being a snowboarder, very much like solo endeavors for the most part, where mm-hmm. it's just you kind of challenging yourself. But acting, I feel like going into an audition, there's so many other factors to you getting the role that no matter how great you are in the room, does that become frustrating for somebody that wants to be a professional?
It's part of the business. You're absolutely right. There's so many factors that you have no control of that, you know, the producers and directors, I believe, always, I feel like, have an idea of who Joe or Bob is in their mind, because they're always basing on people that they know, or if it's based on a true story, basing on people that they've met or whatever it is. And, you know, it's one of those things that's, you know, it's a double-edged sword. Do you go in and try to replicate who that person is, or do you go in and you present who you feel that person is? And, you know, you have to go in, you know, not caring whether you get it or not. You have to just kind of bring them your best work.
I feel like that is such an easy thing to say, but it's got to be a hard thing to try to get to accept.
Of course, you have to accept. That's what it is. It's acceptance. Because you're saying, you know, sports and cooking and all this stuff, it's all kind of like self-indulgence, and you're competing against yourself. But with acting, it's the work that comes first. It's all about the work and like what it represents. And it has something to do with the actor, but it, you know, it's not, you know, one of the pitfalls that actors have, and I'm guilty of this, is what one of my greatest teachers, Wynn Handman, who's taught everybody from Red Buttons to Richard Gere, told me that, you know, a lot of young actors have what's called theatrical masturbation. And so they're up there only pleasing themselves. And that's what you have to really watch out for, because it's not about it's not about you. It's about the work. It's about what the work is about.
You mentioned Red Buttons. Are you a fan of like film history? Do you love diving back into old performances from characters, actors that are no longer with us?
Sure.
Because I feel like many actors today, they're just like, they're working on what they're now, but you reference a film from, you know, pre-80s, maybe 70s, and they're like, no, I've never heard it, never seen it.
That's probably a lot of millennials, though. I mean, you know, you and I grew up in a time where if you turn on the TV, there'll be something on from the past. Nobody watches TV anymore. Everybody has their iPads or their phones, and they're just, everything is on demand. And now, you know, it's, you know, that generation is past, you know. But look, I grew up watching Laurel and Hardy and, you know, Abbott and Costello and all the you know, all that stuff. My hero growing up as an actor was Jack from Three's Company, John Ritter.
Oh my gosh, that shows.
He was like my icon growing up, like the person that I wanted to be, and he was such a talented person, such a talented actor.
Just like a great acting, but also physical comedy as well.
Too. And it's such a, you know, he's one of those people that you can tell is you would have a lot of fun with. Like when you first meet somebody, you know, there's an instinct there. And I never met him, but I can tell right off the bat, I would have loved to hung out with him.
And as you mentioned, Abbott and Costello, like Abbott and Costello meet Frankenstein, still just...
classic. Yes. Who's on first?
Oh, yes.
I was watching Rain Man the other day, and I got a kick out of it.
That is the kind of cool thing, as you mentioned, growing up, because you didn't really have a choice about what was on the TV when you turned it on. Mm-hmm. Now you're right. You can, if you're not interested in something, turn it off. I'm going to find something elsewhere.
And watch it. Look, that's great. I think it's the way it should be, you know? Less commercials.
Sometimes unfortunately, you're like, oh, can I? No, I can't. I got to sit through and watch this. But no, you have also a production company as well. Lucky Film Productions.
Lucky Film Productions. That's right. I just started up this past year, because now I'm fortunate enough to be working on producing films as well. So I have a sci-fi film that I'm a co-producer on, along with Ryan Carnes from Desperate Housewives, called Amaranth. I'm producing a film that's based in Chicago, your hometown.
Yes.
Called Mr. Chicago. And it's about Gary Gold, who was the right-hand man of Mayor Daley of the 60s, 70s era of Chicago.
Such an infamous time for Chicago.
And, you know, he as well. And this is why we're so... Not only do we look alike, but in a sense, our lives mirror each other, that the things that he did and the people that he knew, when you read it on paper, it almost sounds fake, but it's so real that it could only happen in that kind of confluence, you know, of someone's life, of just kind of like being there at that time. You know, it's amazing, amazing story. We have Paul Sorvino attached. We have a couple of really interesting people. And I'm really looking forward to both of the Amaranth and Mr. Chicago getting done.
So what was it like, what made the decision, you know, you want to hop from just being in front of the camera, but you also want to hop behind the camera as well and start having a hand in the things that are being created?
Well, I've always liked to write. I have my bachelor's degree is in writing. And I've always liked the creative process. So it takes a lot of creative people. It's one thing that I'm really good at is like, you know, just seeing things before they happen. Now on the flip side, the money side, I don't know. I'm horrible at it. And I would never make believe that I knew what I was doing, but that's why I have good people that are with me to do that.
Yeah. I feel like that's the key to success is creating a team that everybody has that brings their own strong suits.
Absolutely.
To that.
And then absolutely.
So now we're talking about films, though. One film that you were in, My Dead Boyfriend, Heather Graham, but then also directed by Anthony Edwards, too.
Yeah, it was his first film that is there. Right. Yeah, he was, you can definitely tell that he was like, you know, felt like he was on the radar, you know, like he was like every second counted. But on the other sense, he was a really nice guy. He was like, you know, when it was time to kind of chill, he was chill. There was a moment one time where Heather and I and the rest of the band, because we were in a band together, we were just, you know, messing around on our instruments. He's like, "Can I have a second?" And Heather was like, "Chill, dude." He's like, "Okay, I'm sorry. You know, but we had a great time. Heather is a really, really fun to be with. She's like, you know, really elegant, pretty now. You know, she's always been beautiful, but she got that like nice, elegant kind of look about her now. Which is nice.
And I imagine for Anthony, I mean, you know, not only being in films, if you think of like the classic, like Revenge of the Nerds, things like that, but then also ER for so long too, as well. He's been around
for so long. Like if you look back, like you said, like Revenge of the Nerds, he doesn't even look like that. Like it doesn't even seem like it's the same person, but really nice guy, really talented too. And he's still acting. He was just on Law & Order SVU like a month or two ago.
Oh, cool.
So he's still working as well.
I imagine even being around all that, this, when you first get the chance to step into the director's seat, even being around it for a majority of your life, it's still got to be kind of a, I don't want to say overwhelming, but it can be a little nervous experience.
You know, in our business, it only takes one bad performance to kind of like make people say, all right, let's not work with him again. And it doesn't matter who you are. It honestly doesn't. You could be anybody. You have to be able to produce and to do good work every time. It's not, you don't get any free rides here in the entertainment industry. You don't.
No. So now you're talking about Lucky Film Productions, and you've got your two projects coming up. What was it about, as you said, you're not really, because you're doing a sci-fi film, but you said, you know, I'm not one about like CGI, things like that. How do you want to do a sci-fi film, but still kind of keep it centered on the human story and not so worried about letting the CGI kind of overwhelm everything?
You look at, like, let's say remember the aliens of 1986. Mm-hmm. You know, there was no CGI back then. It was very, very, it was very dark. It was about the people. And I'm not saying our film was about aliens in any way. Our film has to do kind of with a post-apocalyptic world where people are trying to survive, and people are killing other people in order to do that. And that's what it's about. It's about the people, it's about the community, the story, and the struggle that they go through in order to kind of overcome their own demise, because it's, you know, it's other people who actually create this war, this nuclear war that they have to come out from under, you know? And that, you know, I hate looking at all this stuff where you kind of, it's all this like stuff that's not real. It's not like, you know, it's coming out of a computer. That's what I don't like.
So for you, do you feel like doing something in more of the sci-fi genre is pushing yourself? Because certainly doing something like the Chicago Project there, that's something that you kind of, you know, that life, that experience. You've kind of been tangential to it growing up. But tackling something in the sci-fi genre, how do you feel about it? You're kind of like, this is a challenge I'm ready to take
It's
on.
A challenge, but it's also, it's something I grew up with. Like, you know, I feel like a lot of those sci-fi films that are going on today are based on the classics from when I was young. And, you know, it, I like it. If you want to call it a challenge, I'm up for it.
I feel like the best science fiction is always almost like a morality play, where it kind of just takes a very essential human truth and just gives it the trappings of science fiction.
Right, right. The sci-fi stuff is in the background. What's in the forefront is what's really important. Yeah.
So now, when do you actually start shooting in Chicago?
So the Mr. Chicago, we're looking at it in about a year from now. So we're still, you know, signing on actors, getting locations, stuff like that. For Amaranth, we're a little closer. We're looking in about, I'd say about 4 months from now. So we're already kind of, we have locations and stuff like that in place, and we have key actors in place. So now it's just a matter of time to begin that.
So as somebody who's a perfectionist, do you find as you're gearing up for all this stuff, and actually when the production starts, are you going to find yourself just involved in every part, every aspect of the production? Are you going to be able to kind of step away and let these people kind of do their thing?
Right. That's one of those things where you have to surround yourself with people you can trust and allow them to take part of that load and not overwhelm yourself. So one day I might be on set and helping the director with the actors. There might be another day where I'm kind of looking, helping the set designer, kind of like making sure that the set looks good. So it's spreading yourself around, not allowing yourself to kind of like overwhelm yourself with any one thing.
Has it been easy for you to kind of step back from that, or has it been a kind of struggle being such a perfectionist to kind of find those people that you can trust?
You know, it comes from experience. You know, if you're looking at it from that point of view where what you're thinking is perfect, you're going to go against everybody else. You have to kind of like think about what the group, in a sense, thinks is what the next step is, and then perfect that.
Now, as we're talking about groups, about mobs, the making of the mob from AMC, playing Lucky Luciano.
Yeah.
How does that project come across your desk? And when you hear the chance you get to play this world famous mafioso, how excited were you for this?
I was, you know, it was one of those weird events where I went in, and I auditioned. I think the first audition I went in for was like Bugsy Siegel. And then I went in and auditioned for Vito Genovese. And then I went in and I auditioned for this guy and that guy. And I'm like, man, these people don't know what they want, like, you know? And then the casting director calls me and says, look, Rich, we love you. The director loves you. We want you for the lead role. The only thing you need to do now is come in, put on a pair of brown contacts, let us dye your hair black, put on a vintage suit, send your pictures over to the executives at AMC, and if they okay you, you're in. And I'm just glad that I got it, you know, because if I had to do all that and not get it, it was one of those like moments like, see you later.
I can imagine when that call comes, you're like, I could be there in 10 minutes.
Well, look, you know, it was great. It's great to get it. And it was an opportunity for me to play a lead role on a major network. It was an opportunity that I knew that I was going to take full advantage of. And I'll tell you, I worked 18-hour days and I didn't take a minute off because I knew that it was my face and it was going to be the first chapter of my life. My acting career was on the line, and that's the most important chapter. And, you know, we were supposed to do one season, and we grew such a huge fan base that they did the second season and hopefully now a third season. And we had a huge response from the public to watch that show, you know, and the entire cast was great. I mean, you know, when you get together with a group of people and you can kind of sense what the other person is going to do before they do it, that doesn't happen a lot. And it was really, I felt very lucky to be a part of that.
Now, growing up as something kind of tangential, sort of like the mob families, the Gotti side of it, were you kind of growing, did you become like a mob historian? Were you interested in more of the history of the mob? Or was this kind of, when you got this role, it's your first chance to really kind of go back and explore a lot of the backstory and history?
I didn't. You know, a lot of people assume that I went and I kind of looked at Lucky's mannerisms or like what he was like. And I didn't want to do that. I knew, you know, I knew what the head of a mafia family is. I knew firsthand. And it's not that hard to do if you know it. Because, you know, like the old saying says, it's good to be the king. And all you have to do is be. You know?
Yeah, you don't have to show.
That's it. It's a very easy, and, you know, you can say easy, but that's all it is. You just have to be.
And was that something very much you felt like starting being tangential to the Gotti family? You felt like you saw that, just like this is a person that is just
he knows he's the leader. You know, when you're the leader, if you try to be the leader, nobody's gonna follow. It's plain and simple.
So do you feel like portraying that as one thing is lucky, but also just being on set? Do you feel like you're
nobody facing... knew. Nobody knew my past life on set. I didn't tell anybody, and. You know, there were a couple of things that I would have changed a little bit because it wasn't kind of like historic. Not that it wasn't historically correct, but it could have been a little bit more real. But again, we're making stuff for TV. Mm-hmm. It has to be kind of consumable to a certain demographic, per se.
But just you personally, with the rest of the cast, kind of being at the forefront, did you feel like, you know, I don't need to shout and make demands, be crazy, I can just be?
No, I know, that's exactly what you have to do, because you had all these other personalities, like Bugsy Siegel was a very, very violent guy. So was Vito Genovese. Meyer Lansky, for all intents and purposes, was really the head of the mob. It's such an interesting combination of Lucky and Meyer. You have this guy who was born in Sicily, and correct me if I'm wrong, but Meyer, who I met his grandson, who is Meyer Lansky III, very nice guy, lives in Reno, who was, I think, of Hungarian descent, Jewish,
okay.
Who grew up together on the Lower East Side of Manhattan. And Lucky did not fall in or did not do what the other Sicilians were doing, which was to make it just a Sicilian family. His head, his second in command was Jewish, like full Jew. And Meyer was smart in the sense that he never got involved in that kind of like day-to-day gangsterism. He was a bank, for all intents and purposes, he was a banker. You know, he really was. And they built, they created the mob in America, they did. They controlled so much, people don't realize. I didn't realize that Lucky Luciano actually helped the U.S. government in World War II and was telling them where Mussolini was casting his ships off at the time. I never knew that. Wow. You know?
Now, from back then to what you grew up with, did you notice a lot of differences, or pretty much the way that it is kind of run and organized and the way people behave has pretty much stayed similar and constant throughout the years?
It does. It stays similar. The only thing that's different from now to back then, it was a much, much more quieter. You know it's there. You just didn't really know who was in it. And I think what happened in the 80s with the Gotti era, they romanticized it too much themselves, and they allowed themselves to get bigger than who they really were. And that's why they really, you know, that golden, not the golden age, but that type of mafia doesn't exist anymore. They're all white-collar criminals now. You know, they're all part of the stock market and creating these fake companies and laundering money still, of course, and gambling and drugs and all that other good stuff.
Ah, oh, such a great time to be alive.
Right.
Yeah. So as we start getting wrap up, you're out here in Los Angeles for a little bit. Being a foodie, I'm going to go back one more time to the foodie thing. When you're out here in LA, is there a place that you feel like...
Oh, my God.
This is a place that...
I'm about to give a big plug right now.
All right. Anytime I'm in LA, I got to go here.
Oh, my favorite place is the Little Next Door. On 3rd.
Oh, is that the one with the cat on it?
No. Yeah.
Yes,
yeah.
Okay.
So the bakery is the part I like because, I've been to France, but this place makes better croissants than in France, I tell you, man.
I go in there,
I'm being honest with you, I order a basket of croissants and I must have like two or three pots of coffee in like 2 hours. it's so good. I bring it home, I bring it back to New York, that it's that good.
No, because they always say like it's the water in New York. They make like the bagels and everything.
The bagels are the best. The pizza's the best. But to create really good French pastry, number one, you have to do it in-house. That's number one, and they do. And there's a method to it in terms of, you know, the amount of dough and what kind of dough and the water. They got it down, man. They know what they're doing.
For you, as somebody that with a nice cooking background, do you ever want to just like, can I just hang back in the kitchen and watch you guys make this?
Oh, I love it. I do it all the time. I still do it. Like, you know, I love food. I'm telling you, if I was not an actor, if I didn't have to like watch what I ate, I would be like Joey on, you know, remember on Joey when they say like, what if?
Yes.
That's who I would be.
Rich, if they want to follow up on Lucky Film Productions or anything that you're working on currently, where's the best place to find you on social media?
Well, you can just look up my name, Rich Graff, R-I-C-H-G-R-A-F-F. And you can follow me and I'll follow you back. And
look at
what I'm doing and the people that I'm working with and other stuff too. It's not just about, you know, movies and film and TV and stuff. I'm a lot more.
Well, yeah, of course. I mean, we've got the snowboarding, we've got the cooking, we've got being a
everything.
Lawyer, we've got a musician,
everything.
Maybe an author, a poet.
Yeah.
Yes.
I love animals.
Oh, look at that. One more thing right at the end, as if it wasn't enough. Rich has proved this, like, my goodness, he's a multi hyphenate right there.
I'm a good guy. That's the most important thing. Nice.
Ladies and gentlemen, please follow Rich on Twitter and Instagram. Find out all the latest projects that he's going on. My Dead Boyfriend, you can check that on demand.
It's on demand now. It was on theaters for a while. Now it's on demand, yeah.
And fingers crossed for season 3 of The Making of the
Rock. Yes, we'll see.
Oh, awesome. Ladies and gentlemen, my guest today has been Rich Graff. You can follow him all over those handles on social media. I'm Frank Moran. You can follow me on Twitter and Instagram at HappyGoJackie. Thanks so much for joining us. We'll see you back here for another episode of AfterBuzz TV Spotlight On. See you soon.
Thank you.
From executive producers Maria Menounos, Kevin Undergaro, Phil Svitek, and the entire AfterBuzz TV staff, we would like to thank you for listening to the AfterBuzz TV Network. To watch or listen to other after shows and post comments or questions, be sure to visit AfterBuzzTV.com. I'm Sir Richard Wentworth, and this has been a presentation of AfterBuzz TV.
See you later.
The views expressed herein are those of the hosts only and do not necessarily reflect the views of AfterBuzz TV or its owners or principals.